event.
The candle of joy has been lit as we begin today's service, and it is our prayer that we would experience the joy of the Lord as we celebrate this very special time of year. We do hope that you have received a bulletin, and we'll make note of the different activities that will be taking place through our church and through the people who are part of our church in the coming days. As we enter into this hour of worship, we are reminded of a very special verse. It's a verse that describes the Magi, those wise men who traveled hundreds of miles so that they may experience the reality of the birth of a king. And when they found him, their response was quite challenging, because they took the position of submission. They bowed down and worshiped the Christ child. They just didn't pay tribute to him by saying, keeping Christ in Christmas. They bowed down and worshiped him. And then they got really personal, and it says that they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts. The one who came to give us an indescribable gift, he in turn received from these individuals their gifts from their hearts. So let's pray together. Father, we come to you today thankful for the fact that you are the God who is a giver. We thank you for your great gift, the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it is our prayer that our attitude and our time together today would reflect the attitude of humbly bowing before you, worshiping you, Jesus. And Lord, may we be willing to let you open up our treasure chests, and may we willingly respond as you open up yourself to us to give you our very selves. It's in the blessed name of Christ we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah, how it rings.
it says, oh, how much God gave to us that day. From the manger bed, what a path has led. What a perfect, holy way. Because we know, they didn't know at the time, but we know now that that path was going to lead to the cross. And that, after then, is leading the way and the hope and giving us the promise that one day we will see that King again in heaven. They didn't know it at the time. Mary and Joseph didn't know. The shepherds didn't know. The three wise men didn't know. But now we look back and we know. Let's sing Child in a Manger.
Child in the manger.
The truth of those songs is seen in the fact that the thoughts that form the verses of what we sung are found in Luke chapter 2. And I'd invite you to stand with me today, and we want to read the first portion of Luke's account of the story of the day of Christ's birth and some of the events that took place during the evening. The words will appear on the screen. I will lead us by reading the black print. You as a congregation are encouraged to respond by reading in unison the words that are found in the red print. And I'll just give you a heads up, if you're reading from the hymnal, that Luke gives some parenthetical information. It's in parentheses, and I left that out. Okay? I didn't mess with the text. It's still in the Bible. But I left that out, so if you say, what happened to that parenthesis? Today, we've chosen not to include it. But again, a very familiar story to us. We will read verses 1 through 7 today, and when we gather next week, we're going to read verses 8 through 20 in unison. Remember, as we read this, it's more than a formality. It's more than a tradition. It's the reading of the truth of the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We read these words. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world.
And everyone went to their own town.
So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, because he belonged to the house and line of David.
He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting.
While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. Her firstborn, a son. And what that was the reality, the beginning of God's plan that he had had from the very beginning, which is he would be a God who is with us. He is Emmanuel, God with us. As we remain standing and sing this chorus together, may the reality of Christ being born into our world go from a historical fact to a spiritual reality, and may he be born in our lives today. Amen? Amen. Charlene and I were laying in bed there. I have the Channel 5 news app on my phone, and it buzzed. And so I checked it. Found out there were tornado warnings in the St. Louis area. And as they gave the story, I heard Madison County. So I sat up in bed and just not only looked at the app, but clicked on it so I could hear the report of what was going on in my home. And I became very concerned because I heard some of the villages and towns where I know you live. And we were praying, anticipating not hearing any bad news. Of course, we learned that though we may have not been impacted, our community has been impacted. And before I turned the light off and tried to go back to sleep, key word there, tried, my phone buzzed again. You know, I found an email from one of you who probably wasn't aware of the fact that we were still in Ohio. And it simply said, "Are you guys okay?" We are privileged to be a part of the community of faith.
Yes.
We'll try it again. We are privileged to be a part of the community of faith. And it's so great to know that though we can't always be together like this, we can always be together like this. Amen. And even though there may be hundreds of miles, pastor can pray for the congregation that's his responsible to shepherd when he realizes they are in danger. And It's great to know that the pastor has sheep who not only go, bah, but ask, are you okay? Just want to check on you. We are going to anoint Ruth and Chuck today. As you receive word from through the church phone line, both Keith and Annette have come down with COVID, and they reported in this morning that they're not getting any better, and they requested that Chuck and Ruth be anointed on their behalf. So if you would like to, Chuck and Ruth, that you would come forward here, if you'd like to kneel, or if you just like to sit here in the front row, that's fine too. And we're going to gather together, and we are going to anoint as we pray together this morning. Feel free to come. Father, we're grateful for the fact that you are Emmanuel, that in your Son, Jesus Christ, we have God with us. And we're also thankful for the fact that because of the giving of the Holy Spirit, we still can experience God with us. And we do pray for our community right now. We are grateful for the fact that maybe that none of our congregation seemingly was hit with the dangers that surrounded us this past Friday. But Lord, our community has been impacted, and we've actually on the national news. And so we take time today to pray for those who are suffering. We pray for the people of our community who are grieving. We pray for the leaders of Amazon as they process what's the next step to do. We pray for the people who may not have suffered any physical loss, but Lord, emotionally, they have to be hurting today. And so we pray for our community. We pray for the people who are grieving today. We pray that as they seek for answers, that they may not find the answers, Lord, but may they find this as a time to reach out and find the reality that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that there is peace, there's comfort, and there's joy, even as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And Lord, we do pray for our congregation. We have the list of requests that are found on our bulletins each week. And we just take time today in this third Sunday of Advent to pray for the different people who are represented in those names. We pray for the names of people who may not even be on that list, but they're very near and dear to us. So we're aware of them because they have shared with us. And because they're part of us, they are deeply embedded in our hearts. And so we just pray, not only for the names that are listed, not only for the names that have been verbalized, but we pray for those people who in the secret hiding place of their own hearts need a touch from you today, need a reassurance today, need an awareness that God is for them and not against them. We thank you, Lord, for the fact that this time of year we are keenly reminded that you cared enough to become one of us. And Lord Jesus, we're grateful for the fact that you were not only born and lived, but you did die. And in that death, we thank you for the fact that our enemy, the one who is not for us, is ultimately rendered powerless. We thank you for that reality. And now, Lord, we come to you on behalf of Keith and Annette. We pray that as they are there in their home, that even as they are listening to this broadcast via stream, that they be keenly aware of your presence. And therefore, I anoint Chuck in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And we anoint him on behalf of Keith. And Lord, we pray that you would go to Keith right now. We pray that you would touch him. We pray that according to your perfect plan, you would heal him. And Lord, we pray that though COVID has made its way into his being, that the COVID will not be victorious. And we pray that your grace would be sufficient and that you would bring the healing that only comes from you. And we pray it in the name of Jesus. our Lord and our Savior. And Lord, we come to you now on behalf of Annette. And as Ruth is knelt here before us, we anoint her in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And Lord, our prayer today is that you would bring healing, that you would bring healing that only you can bring. We pray that as the physicians work with Annette, that the physician will be aware of the fact that there's someone else who's involved in this process. And may they see that it's the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for Annette. We thank you for her spirit of servanthood. We thank you for the way that she loves you. And now, Lord, just do your work in her life. Touch her. Heal her. Bring glory to your name through this situation. In the name of Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. And now, Lord, as we return to our seats, our prayer is that we would stay in your presence. Our prayer is that we would be open to a fresh awareness of what the Christmas story is all about. May we bask in the glory of our Lord and Savior. And Lord, our prayer is, as it says on the screen, that in our lives, may we experience peace, heavenly peace. It's in the blessed name of Christ we pray. Amen and amen.
Okay, before Pastor starts to give us the message that God would have us have today, we have a card. It is his birthday on
Tuesday.
He's going to be
66.
And in my classroom, you now are 166.
And there are days I feel 166.
Because they're always, you know, I always tell them they're 106. So so happy 166th birthday.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. From the Glenview Church family.
Thank you so much. Happy birthday, Pastor. The front of the card says, for God's purpose, you are leading us. For God's glory, you are establishing us. For God's kingdom, you are preparing us. Inside 1 Thessalonians 1:3 says, remembering your work of faith and labor of love. And then this message, thanking God for the love and dedication you've shown as you shepherd our church. He is using you to make a wonderful difference. God bless you and refresh you. Amen. And then with handwritten, it says, we wish you a very happy birthday and many more to come. And as Ruth noted, it says, with much love, your Glenview Church family. And then there's a piece of paper in here. It's got a couple zeros after the first number. So. And thank you so much for your expressions of love. That is the most beautiful card I've ever received as a pastor. And I am going to let you know that I'm going to buy a frame and it's going to be sitting on my desk. For God's purpose, God's glory, and God's kingdom. And we're in it together.
Amen.
I thank you so much. Thank you very much. If you have your Bibles today, I encourage you to turn to a very brief but yet very powerful verse. It's in 2 Corinthians, it's chapter 9, and it's verse 15. Though it's a very short verse, we are going to discover today that it can be the springboard for some tremendous thoughts as we continue to work our way through the Advent season and as we make our way to Christmas Day. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15 says this, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Let me read it again. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. It's the heart of the holiday season, and we've been using some words more often than we typically use them for the other 11 months of the year. Words that fall from our lips are words like joy and carol and tree and food. But there's one other word that we use consistently, if not constantly, during this time of year. It's the word gift. We were driving from Columbus. We had finished our treatment, and Charlene wanted to go by Kohl's and pick up another gift. And it's okay. We'll go by. We're in Columbus. We'll pick up that gift at Kohl's. And we were halfway home, and you know what she said? Oh, we still got to get gifts for. It's gift, gift, gift. We have lists of gifts to buy. We also have lists, especially our kids and grandkids, have lists of gifts that they hope to receive. A verse of Scripture that I've never seen on a Christmas card, but I believe should become a part of a Christmas card collection. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15, which says this: thanks be to God, because He's got a list too. His list includes you and me. His gift includes every person who has ever been born into this world and every individual who ever entered into this world. He has a gift for them. And it's an indescribable gift. It's interesting that Paul uses the word indescribable. He's at a loss from his vast vocabulary to have a descriptive word of the gift that God has given to us. And what's really amazing is when you think of who this is, who can't think of the word. He is Paul. He'd been trained by the most respected of all rabbis in his day. The man's name was Gamaliel. Paul was a keen thinker with a broad vocabulary. Paul was a master of the Greek language, and he was an excellent, capable communicator. Outside of Jesus, there is no other individual in the New Testament era who was as brilliant as the Apostle Paul. He was the greatest theological mind, in some people's perspective, not only in the era in which he lived, but he was the greatest theological mind ever to live in history. And this well-educated, deep-thinking, master of the Greek language individual can't think of an adjective to describe the gift that God has given us. In fact, at a loss to express himself, Paul invents a word. The word translated indescribable here in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15, is found nowhere else in the entire New Testament. This gift that Paul is referring to is so unbelievable, so unfathomable, so beyond an understanding from the human perspective, he invents a brand new word. And of course, the question would be, well, what makes it so special? Why is this gift indescribable? I mean, think about it. It's a baby. We read in Luke chapter 2, verses 6 and 7, two verses that we read earlier, that while they, referring to Mary and Joseph, were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And you know what she did? She did what newborn mothers typically did in that era. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger. I mean, babies were born all the time. There were probably other Jewish babies who were born the same night that Jesus was born to Mary and Joseph. Deal. Why is this gift so indescribable? Well, because this individual named Jesus was much more than just a baby. Standing next to the feeding trough where that baby had been placed, there is an individual, a gentleman, a man, who took the name of his father, but he had absolutely nothing to do with the conception of that child. Well, that's unbelievable. Yep. That's unfathomable. Yep. You can't put that in human words. That's indescribable. Yep. She said, that's the individual, the baby that was born that day, that gift that God gave us was much more than just a baby. He is indescribable. Why? Well, Luke chapter 1 and Matthew chapter 1 tells us that he was more than just a baby because of the fact of the agency of his conception. We can't explain it physiologically. We can't go to test tubes and to look at the most creative and greatest minds of in the area of biology to describe how it happened. But the message to Mary in Luke chapter 1 and the message by the angel to Joseph was, this child is born because of God's moving in our world. And he not only moves in our world, but the Holy Spirit himself is going to come upon the young maiden named Mary. And though she's never known a man, in an intimate way, she becomes pregnant. The gift is indescribable because he was wrapped in much more than just cloth. In fact, as we reflect on the teachings of the scripture today, we will find that though Mary wrapped Jesus in swaddling clothes and pieces of cloth, scripture tells us three other things that Jesus the baby is wrapped in. First of all, the baby Jesus comes wrapped in prophecy. Please understand that God does not need a microphone. My batteries are running out. Are you talking about the batteries? I'll just use this. You're okay. I'll just use this.
I'll just bring them up here.
Okay.
Your batteries are good. The mic's
no, I, when you first said that, I thought, you don't know how true that is. Doctor told me that fatigue and the loss of stamina would be toward the end of my treatments, and no, that doctor was right. All right, thank you.
Sorry about that.
Oh, that's okay. Things happen. Excuse me. Mary gave birth to a son.
Yes.
She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and wrapped him in bandages, clean sheets. But the baby Jesus comes also wrapped in prophecy. See, the thing we have to understand, the thing that we as a church, the thing that we as the people of God need for our world to comprehend is that God doesn't just suddenly drop Jesus out of heaven to earth. For centuries, year after year, century after century, God had announced and prepared humanity for the coming of Jesus. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. The words were penned around 700 BC. King Ahaz faces the reality of a battle that he and his nation are going to lose. And so Isaiah goes and tells King Ahaz to ask for a sign from the Lord that you will be victorious. And the king Ahaz, oh no, not me. I'm not going to be the one who's going to put the Lord to the test. And even though he does not respond to the instruction to ask for a promise to put God to the test, Isaiah says this, the Lord himself will then give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. Think of the irony of that statement. You need the promise of a battle that's taking place right outside your door right now. And so ask the Lord to give you a sign. And oh, no, I can't do that. Well, I'll give you a sign, the Lord says. You know what? I'm going to give you a sign that's not only going to be applicable to what you are facing right now. I'm going to give you a sign on which all of history is going to turn. I'm going to give you a sign that's not only temporal in nature. I'm going to give you a sign that's eternal in nature. And that reality is there will be a young woman, a virgin, who will conceive and give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel. He is going to be God with us. See, it's one thing to understand that in the midst of trials, in the midst of temptation, in the midst of difficulty, that he is God with us. And we can claim that promise. But because Jesus comes wrapped in prophecy, we realize that God's not only concerned about today, he's concerned about all eternity. Amen. He's concerned about the future, which has no measurable time frame. Right. And so he is going to give us a gift, an indescribable gift. The virgin will bring forth a child. Later in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, we see another prophecy about Jesus Christ. In chapter 8 of Isaiah, it describes a time of deep, deep gloom. It is a dark era in the nation of Israel. And after giving that picture after picture of how black it is, chapter 9 of Isaiah, verse 1 says, "Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom." How can that be? Verse 6, "For to us a child is born, a son will be given. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Do you have any decisions that need to be made? He is the Wonderful Counselor. Are you facing any kind of demand that in your humanity and in your weakness you cannot handle? Hey, this one who is coming is the Mighty God. Well, there's so many disturbances. Every time we think we're back to normal, there's another disturbance. Oh, this one, this child, not only Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, he's the Everlasting Father, and he's the Prince of Peace. He is the one that we can experience for the decisions of our lives. He is the one that enables us to respond to the demands of life because he's Mighty God. And if there are disturbances, he's the Father of that which is eternal, and he is the Prince, the Royal One of Peace. Isaiah chapter 11, we read another prophecy. There Isaiah tells us that from the stump of Jesse will come a shoot, a branch that will bear fruit. And he tells us that the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon this one, and he will be distinct. He will be unique. The Spirit of wisdom, understanding, counsel, power, knowledge, and the fear of the Lord will be his life. He will judge, not by what is seen with eyes and heard with ears. And around his waist will read righteousness and faithfulness. His belt reads, his banner reads, "I am the one who's righteous. I am the one who is faithful." And then finally, Jesus comes wrapped in prophecy, Micah chapter 5, verse 2. He's a contemporary with Isaiah. And he points out the city, the exact city, where this gift will arrive. And when he reads that he is going to be born in Bethlehem, as you go back to Luke chapter 1, and then on into chapter 2, and you read Matthew chapters 1 and 2, you realize that we have from the earth's perspective. The baby will be born where? Micah 5, 2, in Bethlehem. And the couple who are going to raise the child, the young lady who's going to give birth to this child, doesn't live in Bethlehem. Oh. Well, see, the thing we need to understand, that the baby Jesus not only comes wrapped in prophecy, the baby Jesus also comes wrapped in history. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 says, when the time had fully come, God sent His Son born of a woman. The King James Version says, when the fullness of time was come, the Message paraphrases it, when the time arrived that was set by God the Father. Throughout history, please hear this, throughout history, God the Father has been working for this event. What we need to understand, and I believe in 21st century world history, and in the histories that's being written right now, we need to understand that events just happen. The sovereign God is always putting together the schedule for Jesus' arrival in our world. What is true of His first coming is true of His second coming. The sovereign God pulls together the schedule for the arrival of His Son. Jesus' arrival is not only announced by the prophets, but the Savior's coming is prepared for by the God the Father. Once the baby is born, what about a language? What about a language? Well, it's interesting that in 400 BC, right around that era, Alexander the Great wanted to rule the world. And so he established and formulated a language known as Koine Greek. It was the common language. And by the time of Christ's arrival, it was the knowledge of the business world. It was the language of the people of the streets. Okay, it's one thing to have this great gift arrive. How are we going to get a word out? How are we going to share it? God has a plan. 400 BC, Koine Greek. Well, how do we get the message out? How do we get it across cultural lines? How do we get it from place to place? Well, it's interesting that when the Roman Empire becomes the power of that era, you know what they do? For the first time in history, they build a network of huge paved roads. They were roads that were very wide and well taken care of. Why? Because Rome believed in power. And if you're going to maintain power, you got to get your armies. You got to get your soldiers from place to place. And so, God not only orchestrates the language issue so the birth of Christ's child can be shared among many nations, but to get the evangelists, to get the messengers out, there's a system of travel that's put in place. Now, we still got this problem, right? The baby's to be born in Bethlehem, and Mary, the virgin, who's betrothed and is going to be wed to Joseph, they live in Nazareth. How can that be taken care of? We read about it in responsively here this morning. Out of the blue, a politician, you know God can use politicians? Never mind. Out of the blue, a politician demands a census to be taken. And every man, please hear this, every man is required to register in the county seat of his roots. So what does Joseph do? He takes a trek from Nazareth to Bethlehem at the time of Mary's expected delivery. Very interesting side note here. We see the commitment between the two of them. We see the concern of a husband who wants to make sure that his wife is with him, and a wife that wants to be sure that her husband is with her when the time comes to give birth. But you'll notice I said every man was required to go and register. I believe that Mary was so familiar, Joseph also, they were so familiar with the Old Testament prophecies that Mary chose to go with him because she was keenly aware that that's where she was to be. See, we've got this magical, this glittery and often unrealistic feelings, emotions about the Christmas story. My friends, what we have is the reality that Jesus is born, wrapped in history, and we have the reality that since the fall of humanity, God has been preparing and pulling off his plan, and it takes place not in just the Advent season. It takes much more than the 25th of December for God's amazing plan to come about. Throughout history, from the time of the fall of humanity and all the way through into the beginning of the New Testament era, God is working. And the people who know him intimately are keenly aware of what he is doing. And I believe that Mary and Joseph were keenly aware. And Mary said, Joseph, well, you can't go. Mary, I gotta go. Why? Well, the prophet said. Ladies, you're 9 months pregnant, and your husband wants to put you on a donkey and take you on a trip. Why would she do that? Well, she realized that she had been given a divine assignment. And she realized that she needed to be where God had appointed her to be. Now, we see the baby Jesus born in prophecy, and he's born wrapped in history. One final thing, Jesus, baby Jesus, comes wrapped in mystery. For hundreds of years, there were prophetic words that promised the Messiah is coming. Isaiah, we looked at his three times. Micah, we looked at his. We could have looked at Zephaniah, Zechariah, Malachi. We could go into the New Testament prior to Jesus coming. John the Baptist. The Messiah is coming. Be ready. God's gift is arriving. Now the thing we have to understand is that when Rome comes into power, it pushes Israel around. Please make note of that. In fact, one of the reasons the people of Israel are crying out for the Messiah is because for centuries, the different world powers have walked all over their nation. They're right there in the center of the Middle East, and whenever there was a war going on between empires, they would come through. I mean, fact is, the Jewish people, the Israelites, they were so sick and tired of being pushed around, taken advantage of. The people of God felt as if the boot of Rome is on their throat and choking them to death. And they anticipate a Messiah who will arrive in bright and shining armor, that he would ride a white horse, and when he came, they would overthrow Rome. A militaristic, worldly power. But he arrives wrapped in mystery. Someone who's going to change the world? Surely there would be a big, awesome, stupendous ad campaign. At downtown Jerusalem, there would be an all-day spectacular. Bands, banners, noise, fireworks. The mystery is, Jesus is silently delivered. You know what his first nursery was? Common, ordinary stable. You know what his first cradle was? An animal's feeding trough. Gathered around him was not a who's who of the world leaders and powers of that era. gathered around him were his mother, his earthly father, and a few animals. Well, what about going public? When the good news goes public, you know what God does? He slips out of town where a few unnamed shepherds are huddled. And through an angel speaking and an angelic choir singing, those who the world considered as worthless are told about Jesus' arrival. He comes wrapped in prophecy. He comes wrapped in history. All creation has anticipated the day when Jesus will be born into this world. The Messiah is coming. And the mysterious thing of it all is he comes quietly and silently. And what I love about those shepherds, we read in Luke chapter 2, verse 17, we read these words, when they had seen him, they followed the words of instruction that were given to them, and they go, they find the stable, and they find the Christ. Every nativity scene should have Christ as the center point. And when they come to the stable and they find the Christ, Luke 2:17 says, they spread the word concerning him what had been told them. You hear it? He's indescribable. They didn't know what to say as they spread the news about the gift of God they had just seen. And so they said, well, this is what we were told about him. He truly is. Jesus Christ truly is an indescribable gift. We don't have the ability to describe him in our own words. Gifts. 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 My hope is as we enjoy the receiving of gifts these next few days, may we choose to receive God's indescribable gift. See, the good news is Jesus has arrived. And we can take him into our lives. Let's pray. Father, we realize that we live in a world that is impressed by what we can see, what we can hear, what we can taste, what we can touch, what we can smell. And Lord, one of the beauties of the Christmas story is that the account is filled with that kind of imagery. The barn, the smells. Isolated out on a hillside, taking care of our responsibilities. The baying, the sound of sheep, interrupted by the voice of an angel. Lord, in our world today, our prayer is that we would just hold firm to the fact of Christ being a part of your plan throughout all of history. Father, as I noted earlier, the bumper sticker that I've seen more than once this past few days is keep Christ in Christmas. And Lord, my prayer is that may we keep Christ in our lives. Lord, in all the giving and receiving of gifts during this next few days, may we take time to give thanks and to invite you to be a part in a fresh way of our lives. those gifts that we receive and give may be shared in a time of great celebration and a lot of noise. Lord, we pray that at some point we would have a very merry Christmas, and not M-E-R-R-Y, but an M-A-R-Y Christmas. For read at the end of Luke's account of the birth that Jesus' mother Mary just pondered all these things in her heart. So Lord, our prayer today is as we go our separate ways and as we anticipate this next week, as we draw closer and closer to the Christmas celebration, may we have time to treasure and ponder the good news of Christ in our hearts. And Lord, in the midst of all the activity, may baby Jesus be delivered silently in a fresh new way into the very center of our being, into the very core of our hearts. Thank you for the good news. Thank you for the reality of the hope and the joy and the anticipation of Christ's arrival. And may we not miss him as we celebrate him this coming period of time. And all the people of God said, amen, amen. Go in his peace, the Prince of Peace. God bless you.